This is part of a module in East called Predict, which consists of a couple of tools. One is called PIP, or prediction interval plots, which creates an intuitive graphical display of future outcomes and helps data monitoring committees make decisions regarding early termination of utility or efficacy. And the second component of this module is the event and enrollment prediction part, which will help you produce accurate forecasts of future enrollment and events, event rates, both if you at the beginning of the study, at the design stage, and in an ongoing fashion, whether you have unblinded data or whether you have blinded data. So I'm not going to be doing anything on the predictive interval plots because we don't have also the time, but I give you sort of like a small display and a reference to that. And in terms of the enrollment and event forecasting, the framework that we're using is taken by the paper by Anisimov and Fedorov, where we model patient arrivals at the site level as independent Poisson processes, and the event arrivals are modeled at the patient level under the assumption of exponential survival, taking inputs from the patient arrivals model. And as new data arrive, the Poisson and exponential survival model parameters are being updated by Bayesian methods. So there are a couple of, in the notes that I will give you out there, we have a couple of examples, but since here we are focusing mostly on oncology, I will focus on the second example. And if you have East open available, you can actually follow through with this, and you can actually get comfortable on doing this yourselves. But for the moment, if you don't, that's fine either. I'll try and be to go through this slowly. So this is the trial that we're interested in, these are the operating characteristics of the trial that we're interested in. So we have a number of values here to take into account. So the total duration is 30 months. We have primary endpoint to be overall survival. So under the control, overall survival is 5 months. Under the experimental treatment is 7 months. We want one-sided 0.025 error. Our enrollment lasts for 24 months. And we want to have a two-look group sequential design. So we're going to have an interim look where we're going to be checking both for efficacy and futility with a gamma of -5 spending function. So this is almost equivalent to an O'Brien and Fleming. It sort of like makes it difficult. More difficult to stop in the beginning. So two-look design, and we have, so this is gamma of -5, and we have a dropout of 4% in a 12-month survival period. So this is the design that we have. We're going to start with that, and we're going to see, first of all, from the design stage, how we're going to be able to do this prediction, and then how we move on as data accumulate into the system. So this is a classical time-to-event design. So we would, in East, we have either designs for fixed accrual or for fixed study duration. So we have fixed study duration here. We have 24 months accrual plus 6 months of follow-up, a total study duration of 30 months. And we want to use a two-look group sequential design. So I'm adding a number of looks of two, and there we have the three tabs. First, having the test parameters, so 2.025, 90% power. The survival information can be entered in terms of hazard rates, median survival time, or cumulative percent survival. So I have 5 months for the control. I have 7 months for the treatment. Automatically, as you can see here, we have the hazard ratio being a little bit above 0.7. In the boundaries, we're going to be using both efficacy and futility boundaries. They're both going to be taken from the gamma family with parameter -5. So I'm just going to use the same thing here for futility. And as you can see, the boundaries look quite a bit like O'Brien and Fleming. It's sort of like harder to stop in the beginning. And you have this funnel shape going on. In terms of accruals and dropouts, I have 24-month duration. I have an additional of 6-month follow-up, so a total duration of 30 months. And in terms of dropout information, I do have some dropout information which can be entered either in terms of hazard rates or in terms of probability of dropout. So in 12 months, we're going to have 4% in either one of the two arms. Okay, so this is the study design. If you compute the number of events required for this and save it into our workbook, you will see that we will need 460 subjects recruited, 375 events in this particular time period. Right. So once you have any design like this, it will be easy to get initially an idea of when you should be expecting the interim looks to take place. Right. So if you look at the details of the design, if you double click on it, and if you scroll down here, you can see that you're expecting the first look to take place after 188 events. Okay, so when will that happen in terms of times? Again, with your design highlighted, you can select the graphs that you can pretty much see and scroll down to sample size and events versus time. Once you look at this, you can see a graph which shows you both the sample size, which is the top maroon line, and the number of events, which is the green line. This is the total number of events. Red, number of events for control. Blue, number of events for treatment. Okay, let me just uncheck the sample size, so we'll just focus on the scale for the number of events. And then you have this floating vertical bar chart, which enables you to say, well, okay, at 20 months, for example, I will be expecting to have, so at 20 months, 124 events on the control arm, 106 events on the treatment arm, a total of 231 events. Or if 188 events is what we're looking for, I can check here and change the axis on which I'm doing the scanning. So I can go through the sample size and events, and I can scroll down to 188, or I can just type here 188. And then you will see that 188 events will happen at 17.3 months. Okay, this is the point estimate when you're expecting this to happen. So what we've done now, we've added the capability of putting variability around this so that you can have a better feel on when this is expected to happen, both at the design stage and as data accumulates. And this is done through simulation. So once you have your design, you can click on simulate to simulate the design, and you can actually enrich the simulation by putting as much information to it as possible. So this is the standard simulation sheet. If I just click on simulate, it will just simulate my current design. So I would be expecting to reject null hypothesis 90% of the time. However, in the include options button, this allows you to get fancier, if you will. You can include also, for example, site information if you have it. So as I have clicked on site information, there's no new tab popping up, but all the information here has been added in the accruals and dropouts tab. So if I go into this, you'll see now that you have a little bit more information. So you can specify how subjects accrue, whether this is based on a uniform model or whether this is based on a Poisson model. And if you have the site information, you could select information that to be entered either sites within regions, or if you don't have regions, just the sites themselves. So you can either manually start typing in this thing, which is not the nicest thing that you can do for a number of sites or regions that you have, or you might have an enrollment plan that you want to read in. So I have the latter, and I'm going to be reading it in. So as we said, whenever you want to import any data in EAST, you would go in the import part at the home screen, and then you can browse through your local file system. If you are following this and you're doing this on the Citrix server, then you will automatically be opening on the, there's going to be a directory with a samples and an R samples folder. So the file that I'm going to be opening resides on the samples folder. If you're doing this with a local installation this file will be on the program files directory. So, which is exactly where I'm going to be going right now. So I will go to C, I will go to program files, x86. I will try and find my Cytel installation, architect, E6.4 samples, and then I will get this enrollment plan. This is enrollment plan OncoX, okay, for this particular trial. And this is a CSV file. You just have to specify what kind of delimiter you have and where do you want to put it. And this is what the file looks like. So you have country, number of sites, the start and the end of the site initiation period, enrollment rate, and cap for the enrollment per site. So once you have this, you can actually put it into your simulation. So I can go back to the input, I can specify the enrollment plan, and since now I have already imported it into East, it will find it. It's the only thing that I have imported. So it knows that this is the one, and I just have to match the headers with the columns. So my region, what I consider as a region, is the country. I have the number of sites, the start and end of the site initiation period, the enrollment rate, anticipated enrollment rate, and the enrollment cap. So once I do that, you can see that it started showing in that mini preview. And then I can go and perform the simulation. Just for time purposes, I'm going to simulate only 1,000 replications instead of 10,000. And the reason is because with these types of simulations, all these data are going to be automatically saved. Before, we didn't have to save any data, but here we're going to have summary statistics for every simulation run. We're going to have subject level data, and then we can cite information that are going to be simulated and saved. So I'm going to hit the simulate button, and you can see that it will go quickly through the 1,000 replications. Indeed, we get a power of about 90%, right? 89.5% of the time we ended up rejecting the null hypothesis. And then I'm going to click close once this is done, and I'm going to collect my results into my workbook. And you can see now that I have plenty more information stored here. All this is all the simulation data. And the graph of the simulation data can be obtained by highlighting the simulation workbook and selecting either the enrollment plot or the event prediction plot. So what I will have is exactly this. So I will have the median of my prediction for the number of events, and I will have a 95% credible interval for that prediction. If I want averages to show, I can click on this box and it will overlay the averages again. So if I wanted to look at, for example, what happens at month 20, then I will have that the predicted median is going to be 266 total events with the confidence interval going from as low as 238 up to 292 events. Or if you wanted to do the reverse calculation, when you're going to have, for example, 188 events, or I can again make my life easier and just type it here instead of scrolling, you can see that this will happen on average or on median at 17 months, 16.7 months, and it can happen as early as 16 months and as late as 18 months, 17.8 months. Okay? Again, this is at the design stage. You're doing this at the design stage with the a priori information that you have available at that part.
Where do you specify the model?
The model, well, as I said, the events are going to be modeled by, right, so this is automatically done. So okay. The only thing that you specify is how the subjects appear.
Okay, so basically you fix
yeah.
the model.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's so for the event time, it's exponential, but for the site, for the patient arrival, it's plus one.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. So once you have now, so this is what happens at the design stage. So now suppose that we have data coming in. Okay, so I'm going to import the data, same way. And I have look one data both at the subject level and at the site level. So I'm going to import both of them into my workbook. So this is the subject level data. Let me import the site and then we're going to see them both. And I'm going to import the site level data, OncoX site. Okay, so you can see the types of information that you have for the sites, for example, what country they were in, what was the site ID, the enrollment cap, the activation time of the site, if the site has been activated, and the observed enrollment rate, if the site has opened. If it hasn't opened, you would still have information on the anticipated end and beginning and end of the site initiation period. And same thing for the data, the subject level data. So here we have treatment assignments as well, but you don't have to have treatment assignment, as I will illustrate in doing this both from a blinded and an unblinded fashion. So this is the data that's coming in. I can go now to the analysis part of EAST, and I'm going to be utilizing this predict functionality. And I'm, as you will see, predict will now has now both an unblinded and blinded data option. So on the unblinded fashion, just to see how that looks like as well, if you click yes, you will get the sheet where you will get to enter all the subject and site level data. So I have site level data. I'm just going to activate those as well. You have to point the system where the subject level data resides, which is what I read in. And then you just have to do the matching of the terms. So in the site level data, I would have the arrival time of the subject, the treatment of the subject, the survival time or time on study, the status indicator, whether it's complete, censored, or dropout, and the site ID, okay, that the subject came in. And then on the site level data, let me just bring that in. So I have site data, which I just read into the software. I would have for the sites that have already opened the site ID, the observed enrollment rate, and the cap. And for the sites that haven't opened up yet, I will have the start and the end of the site initiation period, and the site activation time. Okay, so if I click on next, then it will run automatically the analysis. It will tell me what the observed hazard rates for each one of the group was, what the observed hazard ratio is, and that's where you get now to simulate, conditional on this data, future courses of the trial. Okay, and you can do that, say, 1,000 times or so. So in the accrual and dropouts tab, you can actually specify how your future data are going to be coming in, whether they're going to be coming in according to Poisson or uniform. Still, there's no reason for us to not do Poisson again. And then on the simulation controls, you would have to specify how many you want to run. And again, because of the data that's being stored, I'm just going to run 1,000 to simulate, to illustrate this. So this now, that runs this conditional simulation, right? Conditional on the data that you've seen at the interim. It runs pretty fast. The storing of the results takes a little bit more because it's a lot of information to store. And now if I close this and I save the results in my workbook, I will have this object called predict sim 1 with the relevant data that were simulated.
And I'm sorry, yes.
Yes. Yes. So, right, and then we will, yeah, we get into what I mentioned. So, at the predict sim object, I can again get now the updated events and enrollment prediction plot. So, on the events, you could see this. So, pretty much shows you what the observed events were up until the time of the interim, and then after that you have the prediction. And you can see how results changed based on the data that you observed. So if you look at the other axis, you can see that, for example, you know, 250 events are expected to happen at 23 months, as early as 22.9 and as late as 24.112. While this prediction with the previous plot, if I go back to the design stage, 250 events would happen at 19 months, right, the design as early as 18, as late as 20 months. Okay, so you're able to get an update on those predictions. And you can do that in either direction. One thing that I forgot to mention is that what you're seeing here is, since if you have site information or region information, you're seeing the overall picture. But if you want, you can get the corresponding pictures for any one of the regions that you have in your set. Yes, so this is what the enrollment prediction, let me show you the enrollment prediction at the design stage, what that looked like, and what the enrollment prediction looks like after the data came in. So the same can be done if you're doing this in a blinded fashion. It's the same type of data that you have to simulate conditional on your observed data. The only thing is that you don't take into account any treatment assignments. So again, you will have the subject level data, and the only information that you harvest from that is the arrival time, the time on study variable, whether subject was censored or not, and the site ID, so there's no treatment there. And then for the, if you have site level data, you would enter those as well in the same fashion that I did before, the region, the observed enrollment rate, and the enrollment cap. And then start and the end of the site initiation period and the activation time. Oops, here it's the site ID, not the country, sorry. And then if you get to the next step, then you can just specify an assumed hazard rate for the pooled data under which the simulation is going to be performed, okay? You can specify either in terms of hazard rates, cumulative percent survival, or median survival times as before. And for, again, making this Poisson accrual and making this just for 1,000 replications, you would get a similar picture by saving, again, the same amount of data. Now, the data, as I said, you can save them either in a case form, which opens up only in East, or you can save them in comma separated form if you want to actually process them into a different piece of software. So if I read this now into my workbook, I can again get my predicted predictive enrollment events or dropout plots. So this is what my events look like when I'm doing the prediction in this blinded fashion. Again, by seeing what the mean, median, and confidence limits of the number of events is at any particular time, or what the median and confidence limits of the time is going to be for any fixed number of events. Okay, and that will enable you to tie it up with when you anticipate and try to predict when you anticipate the next look, next interim look to happen. So this is the state of the software right now. And again, if you have any questions or any suggestions or feedback of things that you would probably find useful, I think I already have one, please let me know and we'll be more than happy to accommodate you.
So here you're assuming it's exponential.
Yes. But that doesn't have to be the case. We have functionality within the software. Like if you go into the simulation sheet of the software when you're simulating, let me edit my simulation. You can actually do this for utilizing R. So under the include options, let me just take sites off. If I select use R, user defined R function, then you get this tab here, which allows you to specify your own R function to either generate responses from, calculate different test statistics if you don't like to use the log rank, perform randomization differently, generate arrival times differently, dropout information differently. So with this, if I wanted, for example, to generate from a Weibull instead of an exponential distribution, I could go here and I could say, well, this is, I just need to point to where the file is, and then from within that file I'll have to copy and paste the name of the function that will do the generation from the Weibull distribution. And I can generate, well, I can try sort of like a viable 1-1 just to make sure that the results, you know, are the same as the exponential, or I could try viable with shape parameters below 1 or above 1 to get closer or farther away from the null hypothesis and see what the effect of the power, for example, is going to be. And once you do that, as I said, you just need to copy the name of the file, of the function, and paste it up here on the function name. And once you do that, you can just hit the simulate button. And then the simulation is going to be done under that particular distribution.
Now your event projecting is based on viable distribution now. If you use this one, so basically your event projecting is based on viable distribution.
Yeah. So all these, now the syntax, of course, of the R functions is sort of like a little peculiar. It's not your standard sort of like R function. There has to be a certain input and certain output components in the function. And we have created, as I mentioned earlier, pretty extensive appendices that will help you tailor the templates that we have to your liking. So we have put in different templates in the same directory as the one that I got this from. Oops, not view, browse. So we have different templates for and different sample programs for each one of these things, whether you want to use different test statistics, dropout patterns, response samples, and we have templates as well. And within the extensive manual, you can also find out the reasons for the syntax and why we're using that.